Hello, everyone. Welcome to Digital Media E10. This is week 10, Colors and Artifacts. So today we have things are set up a little bit differently. So I will be your late night talk show host for this evening. And I actually forgot something pretty important last week when we were talking about digital cameras, which was, of course, a 5-minute interlude showing a video from our friends over at How It's Made. You might recall that from when we were discussing and looking at how the Canon EF 400mm F4L IS USM lens was designed and, constructed. It looked like largely by hand. And so there's a similar session of How It's Made that shows how CCDs are made, and I thought this was an interesting look into the production process behind that. So before we go into this week's material, I thought we would take 5 minutes and have a look at this.
A CCD semiconductor is the image sensor in a digital camera or camcorder. When you snap the shutter or press record, you expose the CCD to patterns of light. It captures them electronically by converting them into millions of electrical charges. The camera's processor then reads these charges and translates them into pictures or movies. CCDs, or charge-coupled devices, are made of silicon, the main element in sand. What's special about silicon? When light hits it, you get electrons. Production begins with a round silicon wafer, 6 inches in diameter, and about as thick as a shirt cardboard. It goes into a steam oven for 3 to 4 hours. The intense heat, along with oxygen and hydrogen gases in the steam, create a glass-like layer on the wafer. This insulates the silicon against the miniature electrical circuitry that will be built on top of it. But first, the wafer is covered in conductive material. This layer measures less than a micron. A human hair is 100 times thicker. Next, a robot applies a 1 micron thick layer of photosensitive resin, which will undergo a chemical reaction when exposed to light. A technician places a mask over the wafer. The pattern on this mask is the schematic for part of the circuitry. When you take a picture, you expose the silicon wafer to light, and that generates electrons. The circuitry carries those electrons to the camera's processor, which reads the charges and translates them into an image. This machine exposes the masked wafer to ultraviolet light. The resin underneath the circuitry pattern remains intact, protecting the conductive layer beneath it. The resin on the areas not masked by the circuitry pattern needs to be removed. Chemicals are sprayed on. This dissolves the resin, exposing the conductive layer underneath. Technicians repeat this entire process with anywhere from 13 to 30 masks until they've built up the full circuitry pattern on the wafer. Next, technicians submerge the wafer in acid, which eats away the uncovered conductive layer. So now, the only conductive material left on the wafer is the actual circuitry. Next step, a thorough rinsing in tap water to remove the residue. Then a rinse with purified water to remove any impurities left by the tap water. Throughout production, contamination is a concern. A single speck of dust can ruin an entire wafer. To protect and insulate the circuitry, the wafer is coated in liquid glass, then baked for 2 hours until the glass hardens. The wafer surface is divided into 25 million tiny square cells called pixels. When you take a photo, each pixel records the light intensity of a minute portion of the scene, generating an electrical charge. A filter on the CCD translates each pixel charge into color. The company makes this filter with 3 pigment powders, red, green, and blue. These 3 colors combined in varying ratios can reproduce any color. The camera's processor reads and then reconstructs the photograph scene pixel by pixel. Each finished CCD undergoes a battery of automated tests to ensure that all the circuits are functional. The machine marks faulty circuits with ink. Just one bad circuit means the entire CCD needs to be discarded. Technicians then check every CCD under a microscope, looking for scratches that might have occurred during the production process. The number of pixels on a CCD varies, depending on what type of camera it's for. This one is a 25 megapixel CCD, meaning it has 25 million pixels. This company even produces a single CCD that has 111 megapixels. So the next time you say cheese, remember that you're producing a digital photo thanks to all that painstaking work that went into the sophisticated CCD semiconductor inside your camera.
All right, so that was just a very quick look into the production of CCDs themselves, but I hope you noticed that when they were showing the pattern of color filters, that it actually was the Bayer color filter array. It was the pattern of the blue, green, green, red, and repeated pattern that we actually got a chance to see last week. It's sort of interesting also that some of the colors you may have noticed in that video didn't actually look very true, and we will actually talk about that a fair amount today in our discussion about color and artifacts. So if we dive into some of the stuff that we wanted to talk about today, of course, this being the beginning of class, I wanted to provide a few reminders. Project 4, the last of the numbered projects, is due today, tonight at 11:59 p.m., Problem Set 5 was released last week and is due this coming week. Again, keep in mind that there are separate versions of Problem Set 5, whether you are registered as an undergrad or a graduate student in this class, so please be sure that you complete the appropriate portion there. We just released the last assignment of this class, which is the final project. As soon as you are ready, take a look at that, because the first due date for the final project is coming up in 2 weeks from today, which is the final project proposal, where you just provide to us a little bit of information about your plan for the final project, and then from then until the rest of the, until the time that the final project itself is due, you will have an opportunity to work on that final project. Now, the reason that we ask you to provide to us a final project proposal is that we give very little direction for what we want you to do in the final project. Again, look at the specifications to see exactly what the minimum requirements are. But in general, you can essentially create any final project that you want so long as it is based on still photographs. So in the past, we've had people submit time-lapse videos, for example. They've done stop-motion animation, which, of course, are based on still photographs, but the end product is a movie file. We've had people that were interested in the historical context of their community, and so they took National Geographic-style photographs of their community and accompanied it with a little article that provided some historical context. We've had some people that have done websites based on photographs. So one person that had a little bit of technical know-how created a website that showed a face, for example, with arrows at eye level, nose level, and mouth level. And when you clicked on one of those arrows, it would actually change the mouth, the nose, or the eyes to some other person. And you could then mix and match different people to get a different looking face, which was actually a really neat final project. But these are all just examples. There's very little direction that we provide. We hope that if you came into this class with some project in mind, that it is flexible enough for you to be able to implement that project for your final project proposal. So do take a look at the PDF. I have a copy of it here. And there are a few things that I want to mention about this just right now. One of them is that be mindful of the final project proposal deadline. We do require that in order to accept the final project, we must approve your proposal. In other words, we just want to make sure that you are about to attempt a final project that is of the correct scope, that meets the relatively loose guidelines that we provide here. Now, in terms of the difficulty or the ambition for this final project, what we're looking for is about twice the amount of work of one of the numbered projects. So imagine how much work you put into Project 2, for example, or perhaps even more recently Project 4, and double that, and that's about how much effort we are looking for in this final project. And given that you have over a month to complete the final project, and after you submit the proposal, you will have a month to complete the final project. We hope that that is sufficient time to complete this. We do say that your final project, no matter what style you end up picking for the ultimate submission, that it is based on no fewer than 5 or more digital images. So if you do decide to do even just the standard, well, not necessarily standard, but even an exhibition, or you just want to provide a series of photographs, that's certainly within the bounds of this final project. You don't have to do something super crazy like stop motion or anything like that, but we say that you can if you want to, but we require that you have at least 5 images. And obviously, if you have fewer images that you're submitting, then we expect a lot more work goes into each one of those individual images to make up for the fact that there are relatively few images in that. Now, in terms of the requirements for the final format, if you are presenting to us still images, then probably JPEG is the correct choice. But if you're going to submit something else, like stop motion animation or a movie file or a web page or something like that, then maybe just JPEG files by themselves don't make a lot of sense. So there is more leeway here as well. And you'll notice that when you take a look at the proposal requirements, we ask that you tell us precisely what we should expect in terms of your final project. So what is the ultimate goal? Is there an underlying theme that connects all of those images? How do you plan to submit that to us in terms of the format of those files? And how many images do you approximately expect to take, and what's the workload going to be, that sort of thing. So our goal will be, since that proposal is due the week before Thanksgiving, our goal will be to provide feedback to you. It will be very simple. This sounds great, go ahead, or maybe let's do a revision of this proposal so that it actually meets the minimum specifications that we require before Thanksgiving, so that you will have time to work on that over break and for the first few weeks in December. But make sure that if you want that to be the case, please be sure to submit this proposal on time by 2 weeks from today, on Thursday, November 19th. Are there any questions on this? So other than the execution of the final project itself and the proposal, there's also just a very small, very short sort of paper that goes along with it. This is not meant to be in depth or very long. It's just supposed to be sort of similar to the behind the scenes from Project 2. Just tell us a little bit about what it was like to complete this project, and make sure that you tie up any loose ends in that paper, such as there is a sort of a requirement in this project that you use some element from this course, and so that would be a perfect opportunity to make that justification in your final project. We also go into a little bit of detail about how we will, just a little bit of detail about how we will grade it, and grading the final project is very similar to the numbered projects, where we have these quantitative measures, but we also have this subjective measure. And like other projects, we are comparing your photographs compared to where you started in the class, not necessarily against everyone else, since there's a lot of people that have a lot of varied backgrounds that came into this class. We don't expect everyone to finish this class at a professional level. It really depends on where you were at the beginning. If you have any questions on this, take a look at the proposal. Send us any questions that you have to the staff email address. And again, just keep this in mind for the upcoming due date. Okay, so this week we're going to talk a little bit about color. And I always like this because there's an opportunity for us to take a look at some fun, I don't know, not brain teasers, illusions, I suppose. So how many of you have seen this image in the past? Okay, so don't blow it for me. But for those of you that haven't seen it, take a look at this image. There's it's like a, well, fake tiles with a cylinder on top. Looks like there's a shadow that's created by the cylinder from some imagined light source off to the right of this image. Notice that two of the tiles, one at the very top and one in approximately the middle of this, have labels, A and B. And the point of this illusion is to show you that the way that we perceive things isn't necessarily the way that they actually are. So the goal here is to realize that the tile lettered A and the tile lettered B are actually exactly the same color. And even knowing that, I look at this and I still don't really sort of see that to be the case. How many of you actually see that A and B are the same? Anybody? Does it, even now that I told you? Is anyone? Yeah, let's see. You're squinting hard, but so how many just don't believe me? How many of you think that I'm just standing up here with my fancy microphone and just spewing lies? Well, check this out. Remember, I think I showed this to you a while ago. Anyway, I have this image here. There is a digital color meter installed on my computer, and it shows me red, green, and blue components of the pixel that my mouse happens to be over. So we can see here there's a red, green, and blue. Its values, they're 8-bit values, so it's out of 255. So if I hover it over a white pixel, for example, we see the values that we expect, 255, 255, and 255. So let's try it over a black pixel. You know, I'm just really building up to it now. 0, 0, 0, sure, this seems to be what we expect. So let's take a look then at what happens if I put my mouse over this tile lettered A. So we see it has a specific value here, 139, 139, 139. It's a gray value. And if I now move my mouse over the tile B, we can see that it has precisely the same value, 139, 139, 139. So here's more quantitative proof of the thing that I just said, but this may still not be good enough for many people to sort of understand what exactly is happening here, how our brains are playing a trick on us. I always forget to do this before. I want to like copy this image. Oh, I know. I'll take a screenshot. Whoops. Let's do this again. I'm going to get all sorts of funky noises. Okay. I have this screenshot. I happen to have Photoshop open over here. Now I'm going to open this. It's on this. Hold on. I got a lot of crap on my desktop. I got to clean this up. Okay, hold on. Okay, it's opening. Okay, so this is the screen that we were just looking at a second ago, right? Now, the only way that I have ever been able to convince myself that this is actually the case is to break this illusion caused by the shadow. So in Photoshop, what I'm going to do is I've selected my my color picker, and I'm going to select the color from the B tile. And now I'm going to essentially just create a little bridge of color using the brush from the B tile to the A tile. Now do you see it? It's like, right? It's just like mind-blowing. The fact that shadows, just even though we know that this is not a real shadow, and even though we've been told and we saw using this quantitative tool that actually proves to us that the colors were in fact identical, that the illusion is so powerful from our brains interpreting the context of this that it's very difficult to see until we actually just break this illusion caused by the shadow. And this is really important to notice, that our brains, the reality that we perceive is not necessarily the actual reality in terms of measured values. And this is important as photographers to understand. All right, so let's take a look at something else. I'm going to bring my slides back over here. All right, now, I'm going to describe this to you, but what I want you to do is to take a look at this slide at the black dot. Center your vision on the black dot in the right part of this slide, and pretty soon, in about 30 seconds, what I'm going to do is change the slide, but I promise it's not going to be one of those things where like monsters jump out and it tries to scare you. It's not going to be anything like that. What I'm going to do in about 30 seconds is change the slide to one that's almost identical to this, but rather than us have this image with color, it's going to be a black and white version of the exact same image. So now that I've hopefully talked for long enough, I'm going to change it right now and see if you can pay attention in particular to the color of the image when I change it. Here we go. Ready? 3, 2, 1. I guess not 0. Do you see it? Okay, look away, look away. You know, let your eyes reset. I'm going to go back. And so let's do this again. And you might have got a small hint of what I was trying to get, what I was trying to get at. Did you see what happened? So what happened? Yeah. The color filled in. It was like the correct color. You could see the red brick and the blue sky. It was a black and white photo. So here, let's do it one more time, and then we'll analyze what's going on. So here's the same inverse color. Notice that this is the inverse color of the actual scene. This is not real color. This is just precisely the inverse set of colors for that same photograph. Even just looking at it for a second provides enough of an illusion. So this has probably been long enough. I'm going to change it. This time I'm going to count correctly. 3, 2, 1, go. It's kind of cool, right? So now, like, close your eyes, look away for a second, and then come back. And now you can hopefully see that this is, in fact, truly a black and white image. So what's going on? Well, our eyes adapt to color as they do the amount of intensity of light that's around us. So as we center our vision on something and we see some amount of color, our eyes are adapting to that and effectively trying to cancel that out. There's actually chemical reactions that are happening inside of our eyes to try to counteract the intensity of light, whether that is in terms of luminance or in terms of the color itself. And so when we then remove that color component but maintain the detail in this image, what we see are those, effectively, the cells that are stimulated are the ones that provide the inverse of that color. And so this is actually something that you can replicate on your own. This is just one of my photos that I picked because it is very strongly saturated in red and blue, and so the effect works very well in those types of photographs. Just make one version of it totally black and white. Make another version of it with the inverse colors, which you can do very easily in a wide array of image processing programs, and just create two versions, and then you can have this same thing. Okay, so it seems like we're getting a better sense now of how our eyes can fool us, but there's yet one more thing that's sort of a similar idea that sort of plays on the same systems here, but this one is called Troxler's fading. And so this is an image that has purple dots on it, and there is every like, I don't know, quarter second or something, one of the dots disappears, and it seems to go around in this rotating fashion. So for this one, look at the very center, the little X or the plus sign on this slide again. And if you look at it and don't move your vision, you look at it still enough, what you will eventually notice is something kind of impressive, right? Do you see what's going on? What's happening? The purple dots just totally disappear, and instead what you see is that hole, but it's the inverse color. It's that green color, which is the inverse of this purple that we're actually seeing. So this is a similar thing that we just saw, but now in sort of a motion. So our eyes have grown accustomed to the color that exists around this scene, and as soon as we remove that color, by removing that one dot in, as we circle around this plus symbol, then we're going to see the inverse color in its place. We could just go on for 2 hours about all of the really cool optical illusions that there are, and I'm sure that there's many more that you could tell me about as well. It's really hard for me not to go on and on and on about how cool these are, but these are meant to be representative of just how difficult it is for us to truly have a realistic view of the world as it is, because our eyes, our brains are manipulating the scene, supposedly for our benefit. In fact, there are many benefits to this, but we can see through these specific optical illusions, which target exactly the faults that our brains can cause when we rely on these systems too much, how that can impact the overall image that we are trying to perceive. And of course, there's many other ones to keep in mind as well. We have the blind spot in each of our eyes where the optic nerve actually comes up and attaches to our retina in the back, and our brain actually just fills it with surrounding color, and it's very difficult to see in normal, everyday experience. Even though you know it's there, you have to kind of do one of those blind spot tests and find out exactly the spot where you can't see the little X that they move around the screen. It's actually pretty neat. I remember I noticed the first time I ever noticed this in the real world was when I was learning how to drive, and I noticed that the seating position in my grandfather's car was such that the outside line on the road was precisely in my blind spot, and I couldn't see it. And he's like, follow the outside line. And I'm like, what are you talking about? There's no outside line. It just happened to be just precisely in the right spot, and that was a very real-world incarnation of this. Okay, so let's take this all back to practical means for us as photographers. The main point, again, is that color is difficult. Perception makes our implementation of a lot of the engineering principles in digital photography somewhat difficult. And so there's some stuff we have to do to try to correct our perception, or to try to correct the technology that we use that records the scene to accommodate our perception. So we have this concept of color space, which is essentially the gamut of colors that we can see. And it's important to realize that this is not the entire gamut of electromagnetic radiation, but in fact, these are just the gamut of colors that typical human eyes might be able to see. And by typical, it's like the average of the entire population. Some people might see more, some people might see less. But we have here then a graph, an XY graph, and this is typical, a typical way of representing a color space. Along the outside of this graph, starting from down here in this lower corner, around the outside going in a clockwise fashion, there are some numbers which represent the wavelength of light that produces that color. So we're looking at monochromatic color. So imagine you have like a laser which produces only one wavelength of light. And that would be monochromatic light that's on the far outside extreme of this color gamut. But notice a couple of things. One of them is that this y-axis is approximately luminance, which is why green is at the very top, because it's going to be the brightest. And blue is at the very bottom, because it's quote-unquote darkest, based on our perception. So this is trying to take, then, the gamut of colors that we can perceive and to try to shoehorn them into a graph that is somewhat representative of the way that humans perceive the electromagnetic spectrum. So whereas the y-axis approximates luminance, the x-axis approximates chromaticity, or about how saturated that color appears to be. So even though green is very bright, it maybe doesn't look quite as saturated as like a very bright red to our eyes. And so this is meant to approximate that in terms of the x and y value. So this then is just going to be a way for us to look at various color spaces, which I'll talk about in just a moment. But this actually also shows us something interesting, which is that if we have a light source that emits two individual wavelengths of light, let's say one that is blue over here at the 470 nanometer wavelength, and one that is red over at the 600 nanometer wavelength, the color is mixed, and what we see is a result of mixing those two, which is something in the middle. So only the brightest colors that we can perceive are along the farthest most outside range of this color space. And the only way that we can perceive mixes of colors, and in fact the purple colors that we see are not really a true color, but in fact it's always caused by a mix of red and blue color. And in fact, there's a lot of YouTube videos that love to go on and on about how purple is not a real color. And, we perceive it, but it's not necessarily real in the sense that we can have a single wavelength source of light that actually emits that particular color. So imagine then that we want to produce some sort of product, like a display, a monitor, that is able to show as many of these colors as possible. Ideally, what we would have is some sort of product that would be able to produce each of these individual wavelengths and at various intensities at every single pixel location so that we could then mix them and match them into whatever color that we humans can perceive. But this is obviously a technical hurdle that is just, it's just way too hard. It's not really realistic of an engineering principle. So instead, as you know, the way that we generate colors is to use a red color, a green color, and a blue color in some combination to create a spectrum of colors that we can perceive. But imagine that we have something that cannot actually produce all of the... So as a result of this, we can actually create something that is not actually capable of producing all of the colors that we can perceive. So the reason that we have a color space is that we want to define regions in this entire color space, within this entire gamut of colors that we as humans can perceive, that some piece of hardware will be able to replicate accurately. So in other words, if I have a value of 255 for green and 0 for blue and 0 for red, so representing some bright green value, we probably need to have some sort of definition for what that value is actually going to represent along this color space. And that's exactly what color spaces do. So this is an sRGB color space. It defines a range of colors within the entire gamut that we can perceive that that technology, displays, printers, cameras should strive to replicate accurately. So in other words, notice that there's three dots on this color space, each one representing a red color, a blue color, or a green color. And notice that these would then be the green values, the red values, or the blue values that are represented when I have some value of red, green, or blue that is maxed out. So a 255 value of green and a 0 value for blue and a 0 value for red would represent this topmost vertex of this triangle. So another way to think about this is that we have a file. And this file is representative of an image, and it is made up of numbers. These values, these 8-bit values that we've been talking about up until this point, saying that we have a red component at every pixel, a green component at every pixel, and a blue component at every pixel. And when I have a value of 255 for red and 0 for green and 0 for blue, that this means that I have this full-on red intensity red. But when we apply a color space, what we are actually saying is that it is truly this red at this vertex of this color space. So it's kind of like a paint-by-numbers system. We have numbers, and the color space defines what those colors, what those values should represent in true real-life colors. So this is the sRGB color space. It's extremely common. It's used and recognized by default in almost all computers, cameras, websites, everything. If you are creating an image that is destined for use on the web or on just for display on a computer, like you are in the first part of Project 4, then ideally you would want to use the sRGB color space because it is the one that is most widely understood by default on a wide variety of devices. But there's other color spaces, and we can see why that might be important, because this apparently doesn't replicate a lot of the greens that we can see, that we can perceive. And Adobe RGB is a different color space which attempts to resolve that issue, or at least address it. And we can see the difference between the Adobe RGB color space, which is this one, which extends much farther into the green range of our perception compared to sRGB. So why then is it the case that I would want to use sRGB rather than Adobe RGB? There's a couple of reasons. One of them is that because sRGB is the default color space that's used on a wide variety of devices, if you embed an Adobe RGB color space in your file, recall that this is sort of like the equivalent of a computerized paint-by-numbers system, you're saying that you have this value of green because it is represented by a value of 255, 0 for this RGB triplet. If I have this value of green represented by that value that's defined by this color space at the far end up there, but I have a device that assumes that I am in fact looking at an image that is defined by the sRGB color space, then it will show me a very different green value than what I intended. And we, as just a, society, as a society on the internet, have grown just way too accustomed to seeing one image look extremely different on pretty much any device that you take a look at. If you look at an image on your computer, it's going to look very different from looking at that same image on your phone, to looking at that same image on your camera, to your friend's computer, so on and so forth. And one of the reasons why is because of the difference in interpretation of what those values actually mean, but also the technical limitations of those devices themselves. Some of them may know that you have embedded a color space and that your blue pixel should actually be this true color in this color gamut, but that device may not actually be able to produce that blue color. Or it may be not calibrated properly such that the signal that the monitor is receiving from the computer to display this blue value actually displays a different blue value altogether. So even within the same model of displays, you can have different appearance in colors just based on small fluctuations in manufacturing and small fluctuations in, well, wider range of problems, including the amount of ambient light that you have. So viewing, especially if you're if you have used older laptops from even 10 years ago, you can you might remember the hassle of trying to adjust the laptop screen just so that when you were anywhere near a window, it wouldn't be completely washed out. You would still be able to see the colors and the text that was displayed on that screen. Many screens were extremely sensitive even to the angle that you viewed them. And some screens are still like this. If you view your laptop screen dead on, it might have a different appearance and color than if you go down a little bit and view the same screen. In fact, doing that on my screen right now, which is from a not too old laptop, I see that this color gamut actually desaturates slightly when I change my angle to that screen. And we've just grown accustomed to this, but now, today, we need to realize that this is important when we have a vision for an image. We work hard to edit an image and make the colors appear exactly the way that we want them to appear. We have to do everything that we can to make sure that those colors are accurately described in our image file. That way, when we send that image to other people that also care about the appearance of colors on their display, that they will be able to see that image in an accurate way as well. This is just one piece of them. The color space is a way that, again, we can think of it like a paint-by-numbers system. We have this array of values, and the color space defines what each of those numbers should actually mean in terms of what is the actual exact color of green that I should get with this value of 0, 255, and 0. So we have this color space, which is almost more theoretical in a way, right? Because we have this idealistic notion of having this color space where the computer knows what value of green we actually want it to display. But perhaps this is not actually happening in practice. Let me suspend that. I've been going off the rails a little bit into a little bit farther down in today's talk. But let me talk a little bit more about the color space specifically. So notice that there's a fourth point in this color space as well, and it's highlighted in the very center here and labeled D65. This is what's called the white point of the color space, and it defines what is the exact color that represents white. So when I have a value of 255, 255, 255, what is the actual value of white going to be? You can imagine that if I moved this point around a little bit, I might get different hues of white, even just subtly. Subtle hues of red or perhaps subtle hues of blue to make the image appear cooler or warmer, depending on which way that I was doing it. So D65 is just a common point that defines the white balance. We'll talk more about white balance a little bit later. Now, I also wanted to mention another reason why Adobe RGB is not the typical color space or not the standard color space that you should aim for. The other reason for that is because, we started talking about it, which was that there is an assumption in some devices that the built-in color space is sRGB, and that's certainly true. There is also another issue, which is the device may not actually be capable of displaying all of the colors provided by the color space in Adobe RGB. But perhaps the main reason is that Adobe RGB is used mostly for printing. It's used for, it covers a gamut of colors, a range of colors that printers are able to achieve much more easily than monitors, displays, actual digital displays. I think now, in the past year or so, for the first time, we're starting to see displays whose possible range of colors actually exceeds sRGB. These are now becoming within grasp, but they are still relatively rare compared to sRGB monitors, which really can only, and even only kind of, display the sRGB color space. So let me be a little bit more concrete about all of this. Along with that digital color meter, which is, by the way, included with by default on Macs, there's also this other handy tool called the Color Profiles tool, which allows me to look at the color profiles of a wide range of color spaces. So Adobe RGB and sRGB are two of the ones that we're focusing on, but also there are a bunch of them that we can take a look at. But let's take a look at these Adobe RGB ones, and let's take a look to make sure that we get the same view here as we were looking before. Okay, so something like this, I think we were looking at. Something like that. Okay, so that's in Adobe RGB. We can see roughly that outside gamut here and roughly the range of colors that Adobe RGB can provide to us. This is actually in 3D, which also shows us where the brightness levels, but we don't have to worry about that for now. But we can also take a look at some other color profiles like sRGB. So let's take a look at sRGB. We can see that it has a narrower range of colors compared to Adobe RGB. But it just so happens that I have color spaces that define the range of colors possible by my various monitors. So the built-in one, for example, is, where is it? Color LCD calibrated. We can see that. So here, what I'm going to do is hold this one so that we can actually see. This is the actual capability of my monitor. So I actually had to use the hardware device that calibrated my monitor so that it knows precisely, the computer knows precisely what values it is capable of producing. And compared to sRGB, it's not very good. I guess I have to do this the other way. Let me hold this one for comparison, which is sRGB, which was that smaller of the two color profiles, and show you the color calibrated monitor. So this is my laptop, and we can see that it is not quite capable of producing the range of colors possible even by sRGB. So this is very common. This is not, you know, even a cheap laptop, but even expensive laptops, even expensive displays don't necessarily have the capability of showing all of the colors that are specified by a color space. This is yet again a reason why we may not want to use Adobe RGB, because many monitors just do not have the capability to show the range of colors specified. So the reason why you would want to use it then is for the purpose of printing, if you know that a lab that you're about to send your photograph to is capable of using the Adobe RGB color space, for instance, or your own printer is capable of a wide range of colors that your monitor is not capable to print, then you may be able to get brighter or even more saturated colors than what your computer would be capable of producing by using the Adobe RGB color space. But again, keep in mind this color space idea is just one piece in the puzzle of color management. And hopefully the goal of today will be for you to understand why color management is important and to have an interest in actually having a good color management workflow. So whether it doesn't matter what device you are using to process your images, unless you're using a device like an iPhone or an iPad where you don't necessarily have the control over the display like you would on a laptop or a desktop machine, the goal is to really be able to understand how you can improve your color workflow and make your color more consistent from device to device. And also to realize the limitations of a lot of other devices that exist out there today and their, just frankly, how poor they are at color management. So in color management, there is this context where this color space is really the center of it. This paint by number system is the center of it. And that is the ideal situation, is that we have some values that are written by a camera, for example, and based on the color space, it knows that the value that it recorded should be this color that's defined by the color space. So the camera itself might actually have some profile. It might be set to one of these two profiles, either sRGB or Adobe RGB, unless you're using RAW. And again, by default, you probably want to use sRGB unless you know that you're going to be destining your image specifically for print, and you also know that your printer and or lab is capable of the color gamut supported by Adobe RGB. So by default, we want to use sRGB. Sometimes you'll see some crazy numbers after it, IEC 2, 1, something, something. That's all the same for us. It's going to be equivalent. But here we have a camera that captures an image, records the actual value based on the color profile, the color space that it knows is relevant to that image capture. But the color space, again, is only this idealistic component of what the color, what that value should actually represent in terms of an actual color. There's also a monitor profile. There's also profiles for both your camera and your monitor and your printer and a variety of things that provide very vital information to your computer to say, okay, based on the capabilities of this monitor, when you send a signal of 0, 255, and 0, it is going to display this color value. And that color value may not actually match precisely the value that we want out of these color spaces. The capabilities of our monitor may be smaller than the actual color spaces, as you just saw a moment ago, based on that calibrated color profile on my computer. So in other words, the computer then has to have a profile of the actual hardware, and it's not good enough to just have a profile of the same model. You actually have to profile your actual monitor, because your monitor will be unique and will have manufacturing defects, even minor ones, or just normal variances in manufacturing that cause it to display colors at different saturations and hues at the same value, at the same signal being sent by your computer. The color profile allows the computer to translate the actual color that it wants to display in the working color space to the closest value that can be displayed by your monitor. So the important step here then is profiling your monitor to do actual hardware calibration of your monitor, which will then create a profile and tell your computer how to properly display those colors. The first time you do this, though, you will be kind of shocked. The colors will look very different compared to what you were used to, and they'll look wrong because you're used to the way that your monitor used to display those colors. But generally speaking, it is technically more correct. And again, based on our perception, that may not be, you know, that may not be what we want, as we saw from some of the examples early on today when we looked at the way that our eyes impact color. But that is, in fact, something that will be important when you want to use that, when you want to have consistent color across all of your devices. Yes? So what happens when you plug into a projector? Do you have to color profile every projector you plug into? So technically, if you want to obtain the highest quality color out of that projector, then yes. But even this projector I've never profiled, and that is why I am complaining like every week that, oh, the contrast isn't quite right, the saturation isn't quite the same as what I would see on my monitor. And the reason is just because of that I don't have the actual physical hardware to allow me to create a color profile for this projector. But in an ideal world, yes, if I want to actually create a proper color management system for this projector as well, then I would have to shell out the cash to obtain that device. It's actually much cheaper to obtain a device. It looks like a little puck, looks like it's sort of like a little hockey puck or something. It has like a little eye, and it rests on top of your monitor flat against the screen. And the way that the software works is that it displays a bunch of colors. and just like flashing a bunch of colors on the screen. And this puck has a way of measuring the color that's being emitted by your screen. And because the software knows the values of the color that is then projecting to your screen, like 255.00 for a full value of red, and because the hardware puck is able to actually detect the wavelengths of light that are coming off, it's able to know what the capabilities of your monitor are. And so recently, it's become a lot more affordable to even buy these physical pucks, but like many things in photography, you can spend a lot of money on one of these hardware color calibration devices. And it's really hard to swallow. It's a very difficult cost to swallow, but it can be important. It's especially important in professional environments when you have multiple editing stations that are working on multiple computers that are editing the same images. You want to be absolutely sure they are showing exactly the same color across each of them. So it's easier to consume the cost in that case, but even so, it's kind of a hurdle that you'll have to come over in order to do that. And again, just based out of just even though that technology is available and now coming down in price to create color profiles for monitors, it's still pretty expensive to purchase the hardware that would be able to do color calibration for projectors or for printers. And generally, it's quote-unquote good enough, perhaps, to download a color profile that applies to your printer, that's supposed to apply to generically all of the models, rather all of the specific versions of that model of the printer. But if you want the truest possible color, you would have to profile your printer as well. So there's small variations in printers, of course, and so having a profile then for that device as well would ensure the most optimal and most consistent color across everything. But the lowest hanging fruit, frankly, is just calibrating your own monitor's color, because that by itself is most likely to be the thing that is wildly off, particularly if you have a PC. And I say that because a lot of the monitors that Apple produces are extremely high quality and sort of well calibrated. Even Apple monitors do require a bit of calibration, but I have seen even out of modern PCs just extreme variations in color profiles that make colors look wildly, wildly different from one machine to the next. There is also the possibility that you can do software only calibration, which basically relies on your perception of the color to try to do some color calibration. And it works by showing like a solid color and then right next to it alternating lines, very fine lines of white and black, and then you have to try to adjust the gray to match your perception. But frankly, it just doesn't work quite as well as using this hardware color profile. Any questions on this? Yes. So, to repeat the question, so it seems like it's in the interest of manufacturers to provide a color profile that applies to their monitor, and many of them do. So, but they only do so again generically for a specific model. So they might provide a color profile for a model of display. But again, due to variances in manufacturing, even the same display model can display the colors very differently. So the only way to truly get, and the other thing, which actually really, which I think really makes me sad as kind of a person that has interest in color profile, is that as your display ages, it actually changes color profile. So you actually have to repeatedly profile your monitor every month or so. And as it gets older, you have to do it more and more frequently, I think, to try to account for differences in the way that it displays these colors just due to age. So it's kind of complicated. It's not an easy thing, just because we do not have yet the technology to be able to produce absolutely spot-on, identically profiled monitors. Increasingly now, there are some monitors that come individually color calibrated from the manufacturer, and those are pretty good. But even still, we notice that the color calibration changes over time, and you do have to recalibrate those monitors. That is certainly a step in the right direction. I think Samsung has a couple of monitors that do that, especially their higher end 4K monitors. But it's the case that we still now have to continue worrying about doing color profiling for our monitors to make sure that we are getting the best possible and most consistent color out of this. And also, how are monitors able to conform to various profiles? So another reason why you would need to profile your monitor is that we do have monitors that exceed the sRGB color gamut. But if they are designed to just display sRGB colors out of the box, all it will appear to be is for that value of 255 in the green to look more saturated and not actually be truer to life until you actually perform that color calibration to your monitor. So it doesn't matter which way your monitor goes, whether it is a subset of the actual color gamut or a superset of it, color calibration is the only way to ensure the highest possible performance and consistency out of it. All right, let's take a quick 5-minute break, and when we come back, we will continue talking about color management. Welcome back, everyone. So one of the things that I wanted to mention is what's going to happen for the rest of the semester. Next week, we have a guest lecture from Dan Coffey, who is a producer at CS50, and he will be talking about how you can transition some of your skills that you've learned in this class that apply to digital photography. We've been talking specifically about still photography, but how you can transition those skills over to film as well, so that you can now switch the dial on your digital camera, which probably also has a film mode, which might be interesting for many of you and your interests. In the week after that, we'll talk a little bit about expanding your photography, but that is actually going to be somewhat different. We're going to pre-record that, and we will show that at the normal time. And instead of that, I will still be here in person, and we can just have a section instead of the normal lecture. And so for those of you that attend live, we will post the lecture online. For those of you that are watching from home, you'll still be able to watch that at the same time and online as well. It just won't be a live stream. It's just going to be pre-recorded. So don't worry, you don't actually have to do anything different, but it just might be slightly different from what you're expecting 2 weeks from now. But this will be an opportunity, especially if you're able to join us in class for the next 2 weeks. I certainly encourage you to do so, since next week we will have an actual guest lecture, and the week after it will just be sort of a much less formal, much more, I don't know if it'll be much more fun, but it will be less formal section time where we will get the opportunity to just talk informally and have a section there. So a couple of the questions that came up during break were actually really well timed, because we're talking about color management, and there's now this sort of awkward gap between, well, okay, I know that for Project 4 I have to submit some of my files in sRGB and some of my files in Adobe RGB, and hopefully now you have a slightly better understanding of why we specified sRGB for the web and Adobe RGB for print. But maybe some of you are actually having the trouble with the practical matter of using that different color space in your software. So realize that depending on how you created your photograph, perhaps you took a JPEG directly out of your camera and you were manipulating that, perhaps that had an already embedded color profile of sRGB. Perhaps you then need to, in order to maintain this the technical requirement of submitting a file in Adobe RGB, you now have to convert that color profile from sRGB to Adobe RGB. Keep in mind that if you want to have proper color management, technically proper color management all the way along the chain, you will take photos in RAW format, and then when you're processing those RAW photos, that is when you will actually specify the color, the color profile that you want to use, or the color space, rather, that you want to use for that image. So you might recall from our More Software Tools lecture that when we were doing that RAW processing in Photoshop, the link that appeared at the bottom of that window allowed us to change the resolution, but also the color profile. That's the opportunity for you when you're taking a RAW file to specify the end product that you actually want. If you're using Lightroom, it works a little bit differently. It actually takes into account the color profile of your monitor and tries to show you the most accurate color based on whatever modifications that you're performing. And only when you export that image into something like JPEG does it then embed the color profile that you specify in the export options. So in terms of using color management, a Lightroom then is a little bit more friendly for us, because then we don't have to create two different versions, an Adobe RGB version and an sRGB version. So these are things to watch out for. If you are working with a color image or with an image that is already a JPEG and therefore already has a color space embedded within, by the way, this is a color space is embedded. It's actually embedded within the metadata of this file, because it's important for that file, when you open it up, for that whatever it is that's displaying this image, to know what those values actually represent. It's possible to create really crazy color profiles that totally change the colors, but that's not obviously the goal of color management, so we don't actually see anything like that. But generally, it is up to the software, when it is opening this image, to look at the embedded color profile and try to determine then how to proceed with the proper color management. But anyway, let's come back to this idea where you have a JPEG with an already embedded color profile, and you need to then change that. You need to then convert it into some other color profile for submission to us, for example, or perhaps use elsewhere. Well, we have this kind of awkward thing, which is that Adobe RGB has one color gamut, and sRGB has a different color gamut. But most specifically, the main differences really are in this range of green colors, right? We can see that, I mean, we really can't tell a difference between the red and the blue points, but the green really seems to extend much farther. And this is important. This means that depending on what colors exist in your image, performing a conversion from one color space to another might actually do different things. So what we actually might want are many things, but perhaps one of two obvious things. One of them is that we have these two gamuts that are different sizes. Perhaps we want to change the relative spacing between those. So in other words, now if we're going to go from an sRGB color space to an Adobe RGB color space, perhaps we want our green values to actually extend farther into that green color space and change the gradient so that, in effect, it appears more saturated. It appears as though we have more greens in this image. The other option would be to essentially just crop those colors out. So imagine that we're going in this reverse direction. We have an image that's created in Adobe RGB. It has these values that extend well into this color gamut, into this green color gamut that we need to then convert into sRGB, which has, again, a smaller color space, smaller gamut compared to Adobe RGB. One of the things that we could do would just be to totally just throw away that information in this higher gamut space and just essentially just make them full green. So the advantage to that would be that the relative gradients in our smaller gamut would then be preserved. We wouldn't be trying to shoehorn all of these colors into a smaller gamut. We would be preserving the raw values of those colors. Arguably, though, what we want as photographers is to maintain this perceptual change between these gamuts, which would then actually perform this sort of shoehorning of this wide gamut into this narrower gamut so that we don't have perhaps potentially awkward appearances of colors when we have some green gradient that just seems to suddenly end. We would have, in effect, color clipping if we were to use colorimetric. Colorimetric is useful, certainly, for needing to preserve identical color and white point and cases like that. But for us as photographers, most of the time, the type of gamut mapping, the type of conversion between two gamuts that you will want to use is perceptual. So imagine then how this might change things if you were going from a smaller gamut to a larger gamut. If you've worked hard in your sRGB image to create colors that apply, that look great, and you want them to be absolutely consistent and preserved as well as possible, if you move to a larger gamut, you probably want colorimetric to preserve those colors as they are within that larger gamut. Because choosing the other, perceptual, would in fact kind of widen those out and might actually make them slightly more saturated, which might be something that you want, but does have that effect of actually changing perhaps the appearance of those. So again, keep in mind this idea of paint by numbers, and I think that's sort of the best analogy that helps me get through these ideas in trying to decide what is going on underneath the hood with color management and gamut mapping and all of these various things. So there's one thing that I want to show you, which is used to be in particular particularly scary in Photoshop, and now in recent versions they've made a lot better. If you used Photoshop even a few years ago, you probably opened a file in Photoshop and got this really scary-looking warning about the color profile is missing from this file. Do you want to assign it, convert it, or do something else? And you're like, oh, God, I have no idea. And you'd automatically click cancel, and you would ignore it, and then everything would appear to be fine. But now I'm telling you that you don't necessarily have to do that, because now you understand what a color profile is. You can try to figure out what precisely you want to do with that color profile in an image. Hopefully, working on a photograph, you have an embedded color profile that then tells Photoshop how to appropriately display those colors on screen. In which case, when you do get an error that says you have a mismatched color profile or there's a missing color profile, now you might have a better understanding, hopefully, of what some of these things will actually mean. If we take a look at the color profile and they change it, I always have to look this up. I love this feature in a Mac where you just type in help, the thing you want to find in the menus, especially in Photoshop, there's so many menus. All right, so it's in the edit menu down here, color settings. If you open this up, this is what has been changed in recent years, and this is now a lot more friendly, telling us precisely what we want to do with color profiles in various situations. So we have a color profile for our monitor that's displaying calibrated color on screen, and I have perhaps defined by default in Photoshop that I want to use sRGB as my quote-unquote working color space, which just means that in general I want to work in sRGB. But perhaps then I open a file in Photoshop that has some other color profile. And these options are define what Photoshop is going to do in those cases. And older versions actually by default had all of these on, ask when opening, and those were those scary messages that very few people knew what to do with. Now, fortunately, they've kind of turned those off, so it's not quite so scary anymore, but you can now decide whether or not you want to turn this back on. Notice that by default, the color management policy for RGB, which is in the vast majority of the time going to be the color space that we will be working in, we are going to preserve whatever embedded profile exists in that image. And generally, this seems to be a good policy because that means that we are preserving that original information, but we can ask Photoshop to convert it to our working color space, which right now I've defined as sRGB. You can see my working space at the very top of this image is sRGB, which is a good default because I'm generally creating images for display on the web or on screen and not for print. So by default, I want to use sRGB. But if I open a separate file that has some different embedded color profile, I don't want to throw that information away or convert it to my existing one. I just want to preserve that information, and Photoshop will still do the right thing and show me the correct color based on that color profile. So how do I get into this screen again? If I go to the Edit menu, near the bottom, there's a Color Settings option. Older versions of Photoshop, it was elsewhere, and this looked a lot scarier, but now they even have this nice description on the bottom that tells you exactly what it is. It's great now. It's fantastic. A few years ago, this lecture was very different when I was like, oh, this is terrible. Everything sucks. Let me tell you a little bit more about it. It's not quite so terrible anymore. The perceptual change.
You are editing with sRGB, which is smaller, but then whatever changes are made, if you had the Adobe RGB, wouldn't it push it up to that?
So this is an excellent question. So the question to repeat for folks at home is, what then is happening if I'm preserving the embedded profiles and I then open an Adobe RGB image, as an example, in my sRGB working space? Well, keep in mind that these embedded profiles are meant to be idealistic, like that conversion between the value and the actual color that it's supposed to display. And the display that my monitor is actually capable of may not actually match any of those, may not actually be sRGB, it may not actually be Adobe RGB. In fact, if we go back to this color profiler, we could see that the gamut produced by my monitor is in fact a small subset of the sRGB color space. So it's not quite that. It's not quite that it is then performing this conversion to sRGB, but instead, in each of these cases, whether it is an sRGB image that I've opened in Photoshop or an Adobe RGB image that I've opened in Photoshop, it's using the profile for my monitor to try to display the colors in as accurate of a way as possible. So the reason that this matters is that you may, when working on an image, want to produce images. If you open an image in Photoshop, you may want to produce an image that has a different color profile than what was initially provided to it, and that's when you would change this from preserve embedded to automatically convert to the working space. But by default, that doesn't apply to me, so by default, I don't want to do that. I want to preserve that existing color space and work in that color space rather than do any sort of conversion secretly or behind the scenes. Yes? So you looked at the colors the photos you just submitted, and it converted to.
It kept it as Adobe RGB rather than the sRGB.
So for those of you, so this might be relevant for many of you that are perhaps modifying photos in or organizing photos in, say, Lightroom, for example, and then you export them to Photoshop. This could be something that then impacts you, because if your Photoshop space, working space is sRGB, and by default you have Photoshop convert it to the working RGB and you import an Adobe RGB image from Lightroom or something, it will perform this conversion for you. So I think the safer thing for us as photographers is to preserve the embedded profiles and possibly, depending on how annoyed you would get by this, have it ask you what to do when you're opening a profile, when you're opening an image that has a profile that's different from your working color space. So in this case, if I open an Adobe RGB JPEG in Photoshop, it would now say, "Hey, check it out! This JPEG doesn't have an sRGB working space like you have specified. Instead, it is Adobe RGB. What do you want to do?" And then it would ask you if you want to preserve it, convert it, or throw it away, or do something else entirely.
So the best method, is that going to take the photos that I submitted? I have to basically re-edit them?
Not necessarily. You don't necessarily have to re-edit them. You can just do a conversion, a color conversion from one space to the other. And let me come back to that in just a moment to show you how to do that, but point out a couple of other things in this display before we do that. So notice that here in the upper right of that same window, we now get to see how we can do a gamut conversion from one color space to the next. We can typically use Adobe's engine by default, that's fine. And here we can see that we have a couple of different intents, the colorimetric or the perceptual. Generally, you might want to just pick perceptual, but maybe you want to preserve colorimetric. If you are converting, again, from one, if you need to convert the working space from one to the other, you simply open this image, and at the bottom of that edit window again, you can then have some options to either assign this image a specific profile, which is not what you want. You don't want to just override the existing profile, but instead you might want to convert that profile from one thing to the next. Now, when I click Convert to Profile, it opened this window, which shows me this. My source space is HD709A, so it's some color space that is defined based on my monitor because it was a screenshot from my monitor. I want to perhaps change that working space to this destination, not to CMYK, but to my working RGB of sRGB, or maybe something else. In the case of Project 4, perhaps you want to change this to something which is off-screen, unfortunately, which is Adobe RGB. Keep in mind that if you are on an Apple machine, there's also Apple RGB. That's not what you want. You want Adobe RGB. And so now I have specified I want to convert from this profile to Adobe RGB. using that Adobe engine, and I then would have to pick which one of those intents, relative colorimetric or perceptual, based on whatever applies best to your case. When I click OK, then the conversion will be performed. In this case, we may not actually notice very much of a change. Let's see what happens. Looks kind of the same. But now, hopefully, the colors that are the values of the colors that are recorded when I save this image will then have the appropriate value for that specific color space. Now, the key thing to keep in mind here is that the whole point of color profiles is to be able to specify exact colors, is to be able to say that this value, this pixel, represents an exact color. And having to do gamut mapping in this way really only applies to these special cases of having to print out, perhaps, an image to a printer that we know has a specific color space. So we mentioned before the importance of profiling. I just want to reiterate that it is, in fact, something that's a very good thing to do. And one way that you can tell how well calibrated your monitor is, there's many ways, but one way to tell is to take a look at like a gray scale that goes from white to black and has a fair number of gradations, and see if you can notice subtle changes in hue in that grayscale from one block to the next. In this case, what I see here on the projector, which will be very hard to replicate for those at home, but if you happen to be here in class, you can probably see that this white looks, well, you know, relatively white, but this looks pretty green to me, and this looks pretty red. Like, it doesn't look exactly gray. It doesn't actually look truly grayscale. There's just this subtle change in the amount of green and the amount of red as you go down this grayscale. Looking on my own monitor, which I have calibrated but not very recently, it looks better, but still not quite so perfect. Now, if I change my angle to that, it looks even worse. All those colors actually totally change. There's one more aspect of color profiling that's important, which is defining the gamma, which is effectively the contrast that your monitor displays information. By default, and now we really don't have to worry about this as much as we did even just a few years ago, it used to be the case that Macs were set to a different gamma than Windows machines, and this was just a huge pain because you would modify and edit your images on a Mac, and then you would move them over to a PC, and even if both were properly color calibrated, one would just look way more saturated, or rather way more contrasty than the other. In general, you want to set, if given the option in your color profiler, you want to set a gamma value of 2.2, because that is the value that is used by most computers and most devices nowadays. If you're using web or Adobe RGB or anything like that, then 2.2 is the way to go. If you're actually doing magazine pre-press or something like that, you'll know, they'll probably will tell you that you should change your gamma, but you would use a different gamma value in those cases. Okay, in the last 30 minutes, I want to now talk about another aspect of color which is very important to us and perhaps will impact us even more and very much more quickly, perhaps, than color profiling, which is this concept of color temperature. So color temperature is really just a way of describing the distribution of tones emitted by some source of light. And the reason that it's called a color temperature is because it's based on this principle in physics of something called like black body radiation, where it emits nothing but just it heats up. And as it heats up, it's going to emit certain amounts of electromagnetic radiation. And it just so happens that our sun has a specific temperature, the surface of the sun has a specific temperature, and it's like letting out all these photons, and the distribution of photons defines that color balance or that white balance for the sun. And you may have noticed as you work with raw images that the color temperature seems to change throughout the day. That's because the atmosphere is absorbing different wavelengths of light and therefore changing the distribution of the wavelengths that are then being transmitted to the ground. And so the distribution then of colors that we see varies throughout the day. And notice actually what's happening as we as this animation happens, which is that as this temperature, which is given in Kelvin here with the K, as the temperature goes up, the appearance is that it becomes bluer. So it's sort of this idea of a hotter fire is bluer rather than a deep red or orange. That's very true here in the context of black body radiation. And it leads to some amount of confusion, perhaps, because we have culturally decided that cooler colors are bluer colors, even though in terms of black body radiation, those blue colors are emitted by hotter objects. So don't be confused by that, even though we will use, even in class, this concept of, oh, perhaps you want to make the white balance a little bit cooler. What we were referring to is, sure, you actually do want to add this additional blue tones into this image, but in terms of the actual physical properties, the cooler tones, quote-unquote cooler tones, the bluer tones are actually emitted by hotter objects. So if we take a look at how white balance maps onto color gamut, we actually see that it really goes far into this color gamut that we saw before. And as the temperatures cool off, it gets closer and closer and closer to these red colors. So candles, for example, a little candle-lit scene might actually have a relatively low color temperature, therefore have a lot of very red hues in it. Whereas taking a picture outside with the sun, it will have a much higher color temperature because, well, hopefully the sun is in fact hotter than a candle that you have burning in your house or apartment. And it will then emit these bluer tones, these bluer hues that your camera is then capturing. So when you're sliding the little white balance slider, what you are saying is that you want to adjust the distribution of tones, the interpretation of the distribution of tones, based on what the color temperature is of the light in your scene. And I encourage you to just sort of play around with it and take a look at, I think that's the best way to get a sense of how the white balance is being impacted on your image is to actually take a photograph in RAW, bring it into Camera Raw or Lightroom or something that allows you to modify the white balance. And as you adjust the Kelvin, notice how the color actually changes on your image. And it's funny because this is one of the last elements of this RAW versus JPEG idea, which is that before we talked about how the white balance was not set in RAW, whereas it was solidified and those colors were defined based on not only the white balance, but also this color's profile embedded within the JPEG image. Using the RAW image allows you then to manipulate those colors in a much better way than simply using a JPEG. So in the last few minutes, I want to change directions a little bit here and talk about artifacts. And so we've alluded to a lot of these over time, but today I want to just make a little bit more concrete the different types of artifacts that we have, show you some examples of them and apply names to them so that you can have hopefully a little bit better understanding of some of the different types of artifacts that you might see. And some of these are due to a variety of things, not just optics, but also the way that digital sensors work and also the way that optics modify the light that is coming in through the front element. So let's take a look at some optical aberrations. We've seen some oversimplified views of lenses in this class before, and generally an ideal lens would converge all of the rays of light that are coming into it to a single point, like we see in this top representation here. But depending on the shape of the lens element and the aggregate shape of the entire lens elements that are contained within that lens, we might not actually get convergence of rays to the same point. So imagine that we have a lens that is shaped from a sphere. So we take this sphere, this glass sphere, and we just shear some of it off, shine some light through it, and we want to see how those rays of light actually converge. A spherical lens actually does not converge the rays in this ideal way up top. But in fact, we see this out of spherical lenses. Just based on the way that they are shaped, these rays are not converged onto a single point, but instead are kind of dispersed like this. So based on our knowledge of this idea of the circle of confusion, what do you think would happen if we had a lens that was producing an image like this, and we captured it with the sensor that's, say, right here, supposedly in the center of focus of this lens? Any ideas what this point of light off in the distance would look like on our sensor? Yeah. It would look out of focus. Well, it would look like it was this blob. It's just like this imperfect blob that was on our sensor. And that's exactly what it was. So frequently we see one way of fixing this particular spherical aberration is to have aspherical components. What that really means is that the angle, as you get farther to the outside, actually changes so that the light that then enters the lens is converged onto a single point. So aspherical lenses are now something that we see more and more, especially in consumer lenses as well, and it really helps remove some of the optical aberrations from a variety of lenses. But this also alludes to something else, which is that imagine that we have an aperture on this lens. Right now, we are looking at this lens, and it is completely wide open. It is accepting rays of light, and it is converging those rays of light on a point. But imagine if we then stop down that aperture, therefore blocking these outermost rays of light. As we block more and more of those outer rays, we are actually blocking those rays that are converging less on that center point. This is one way, one reason why having a lens and stopping it down may actually improve the sharpness of the image produced by that lens. It's also because we are increasing the depth of focus a little bit, but also even in those regions that are in focus, we might be increasing the sharpness because we are eliminating imperfections that might exist on the outer regions of that lens. And focusing then on some of the lens rendering of those images only in the center portions where it's easier for optical engineers to converge the rays of light in an ideal way. So this is just something to keep in mind, is that if you need the best possible optical performance out of your lens, you have a couple of options. One of them is to buy more expensive lenses where they're able to do more to correct for that in wide open cases, or just take that lens and stop it down a couple of stops. Even by the time you get to about f4, f5.6, f8 or so, depending on the lens's maximum aperture, you will start to get to the lens's sweet spot because you're eliminating a lot of the problems that can happen at the outermost portions of this lens. So let's take a look at some other optical aberrations as well. Let's say that all of our diagrams have been extremely simple. Light coming in a parallel way or in a way that's perpendicular to the element itself. But light may sometimes come off axis. And if that lens is not properly corrected, then it can render point sources of light that come off axis in a way that looks pretty strange. In fact, it might look a little bit like a comet tail. And so we would get this optical aberration that we call a coma because of that appearance. And so again, we can see that, take a look at on this image on the right, there's it's breaking down how rays of light through various portions of the lens are being rendered on the sensor behind it. If we take a look at the light that's coming in from the outermost circles, or the outermost regions of this lens, we see that it is perhaps being rendered least effectively on the sensor. It's kind of creating this most bulbous portion of this coma blur. So then stopping down this lens would also have the same effect, because we could eliminate some of these outermost problematic areas of rendering and produce sharper and more clear images. So look at this specific aberration in a little bit more detail. There's this image, which are just a bunch of point sources of light. It's just a bunch of street lights along a panorama. The topmost image is the entire scene. The white, or rather the yellow squares, are crops from each of these regions, and you can see them below. In the center portion of the image, where the light is not off-axis, we actually see it seems to be rendered properly. We can see little circles representing the street lights, but off to the side, we get these smears of coma because it is not properly corrected by this lens. So one way, as soon as you see this, one thing that you might consider to fix this is, well, how much credit card balance do I have? But the other thing would be, can I stop this down a couple of degrees or a couple of F-numbers and try to resolve this without having to shell out additional cash? For those of you that are that wear glasses or contacts like me, perhaps you might have gone to the eye doctor and they tell you whether or not you are astigmatic, which means that elements are not rendered in precisely the correct shape. And, I realize now that this figure is kind of confusing. But if you look, if you ignore this like airy diffraction pattern over here and on the upper left, and instead look at this diagram throughout this diagonal here, what astigmatism would look like in a lens is rendering a point source of light not as a circle, but instead perhaps as an oval, changing it slightly so that it's actually more oval-shaped or elongating it in some way on the sensor. Did I see a question? Mm-hmm.
Is that the same case as reference here?
Well, so the reasons for astigmatism in an eye might be, you know, the warping of a lens, but I think the analogy here is the result of what the result is of the image when we actually see it. So if you have astigmatism of the eye, then it is somewhat similar in that shapes are not rendered precisely. It's not exactly like a square or a circle that you see, but instead it's slightly off, and it may be very minimal. And obviously, the vision that we have or the things that we see in real life are not simple elements, but it can therefore impact our vision in more complex ways than that. But the easiest way to think of it in terms of digital photography is that if we have this circle at a very far distance away, it may not actually be rendered as a circle, instead change slightly their shape. Again, stepping down slightly, your lens may help correct some of these issues. So there's other types of optical aberrations as well. There's a vignette where you can have a variety of different types of vignettes. You can have an optical, mechanical, or natural vignette, and each one of these actually has different results. So, for example, this right here might be one type of vignette where the lens glass is relatively open, but at oblique angles, you don't actually get to see all the way back through to the back of the lens. And so you get this, rather than seeing the full rear circle of this lens, you only see this sort of cat's eye appearance out of it. You might recall this image from several slides back, or rather several weeks back, where this lens, this was the one image that I figured out that my lens has this sort of mechanical vignetting that occurs, because wide open at oblique angles, there's some light that was coming in that was being blocked by the body of the lens, and therefore we see this sort of shadow rather than this perfect circle that we might see in the center portion of the image. This, unfortunately, you could try to stop down a little bit, because as you can see, if you stop down the image, then even off to the side, you can still see the full aperture here, and so you then will not have any vignetting of that aperture. Stopping down would certainly help out in this case as well. But there's also a different type of vignette, like a natural vignette, where it's not really due to light fall off, but it's due to this strong angle that wide-angle lenses will project light into the sensor. And if the micro lenses on the sensor are not really very good at optimizing light that's coming at very harsh angles like this at the edge of the sensor, then it may not be able to collect as much light in the edges as it would in the center, and therefore the edges, and particularly the corners, will appear darker. So this is just another type of vignette that can occur. And this may not necessarily be the fault of the lens, though it is certainly a result of the lens design, because of the short focal length really forces it to be close to the sensor itself. But we might say that this is more of a fault of the micro lenses on the sensor itself rather than anything else. So a couple of other things that are interesting, and I think this is one of the ways that you will now be able to be a lot more critical of your own equipment, for better or for worse. Perhaps in some ways, then, if you know what's wrong, you can then try to fix it later or figure out how to fix it later. And some of you may become a little bit annoyed and realize, oh, this lens is terrible. I'm going to go buy a new one. We're not advocating for that necessarily, but only pointing out ways that things can, in fact, go wrong. So for those of you that have used particularly compact cameras in the past, you may be particularly familiar with this type of aberration where we have distortions because of the lens design. You can have either barrel or pincushion distortions. Barrel, it looks like it's bulging out, kind of like you wrap the image around the side of a barrel, and so it looks like it's bulging out. Pincushion is kind of like, imagine you put a photograph on a pillow and you push the center point in, it kind of looks like it's all converging into the center point. Typically what we see is barrel distortion in wide angle images and pincushion distortion in telephoto lenses. And particularly this is bad when we have lenses that go through wide ranges of focal lengths. If they're not corrected well, then we would see these distortions. So on the left, we have barrel distortion. Look at, see how this window appears as though it's just wrapped on the side of the barrel and it's bulging outwards. And on the right, if you look at these parallel lines, you can see that they seem to kind of be squished in the center. This would be then a pincushion distortion. It's kind of amazing that this is fortunately one of the things that's relatively easily correctable in software. Lightroom even has like a special little slider that lets you adjust the amount of barrel and pincushion distortion. And you can even remember just the value of that slider. Once you calibrate it properly based on some specific zoom level for your lens, you can know precisely what level to set it at and therefore fix any effects of barrel or pincushion distortion that you have in your image, which is a great way to just solve this problem. But at the same time, this means that a lot of manufacturers can apply this software fix without needing to optically correct for it anymore. And in fact, a lot of camera manufacturers these days don't necessarily spend a lot of time correcting in their optics these distortions, but instead rely on the processing in the camera to know what degree these distortions exist and correct for it as it's writing the JPEG. Typically, RAW files will embed this information. So Micro Four Thirds cameras, for example, will just know in the firmware that when you attach a certain lens, it has a certain amount of pincushion or barrel distortion at certain zoom levels, and will record the amount of correction in the RAW file. And hopefully, the RAW software that you're using will then apply that correction, but maybe not. So it's kind of an interesting thing to realize that there are software modifications that your cameras are doing to your images that you may have assumed to be just good optics, even though, frankly, was just done in the camera's processor. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. It's just something to be aware of, that if you do raw image processing, that might be yet another thing that you have to contend with, is actually performing this sort of modification to aberrations and distortions that might be embedded in the raw file or maybe not. It really depends on the context of your camera and the optics. All right, so there's also a bunch of issues that can happen just due to wavelengths. So the way a prism works actually totally exemplifies the next couple of aberrations that we're going to look at, which is that if we have some light that comes into some glass, this change in the speed of light actually affects the angle that the wavelengths are distributed throughout that material. And this happens in glass elements as well. So if we have a glass element, and we can further complicate our look at glass elements, they will actually converge different wavelengths of light, different colors of light at different points. So guess what wavelength we're going to try to optimize for? Yeah, green, which is generally true. And it just so happens that green is between blue and red, which is just sort of like a happy accident. I think that's a Bob Ross quote, a happy accident. But anyway, so we have green, which can be focused on the center, and then blue is just a little bit before, and red will focus a little bit after that. There are special elements of glass, like fluorite, for example, that will attempt to correct this. But you can imagine how this would actually impact your image. You would have some colors that don't focus precisely, and so you might actually have some impact on your images, some softness in your images as a result. And looking at things that come off angle or off center in your lens, you might have a streak of color that can occur as well. So if we actually think of this in terms of a black and white image, for example, if we have a significant amount of this chromatic color aberration, if we have an image that is reproduced by a crappy lens that's like this, imagine if we have like a black and white film or black and white sensor, how this might actually appear. It would just appear to be totally soft rather than to have this definition. And in fact, chromatic aberration is one of the reasons why we have, especially in older cameras, this purple fringing. It's because microlenses might be optimized for green wavelengths of light, and in certain combinations, the red and the blue light may not focus precisely on the photosite in the sensor, meaning that we get this sort of unusual purple appearance around backlit objects in an image. So here, better optimization for microlenses or better materials and microlenses to try to focus these wavelengths of light more efficiently might be able to fix this. This is not necessarily just a feature of lenses, but also the sensors themselves. We've talked actually a bit about diffraction in the past, and what it means is if we sort of consider light to be this wave, so we know that light behaves in this wave-particle duality. If we consider the wave portion of light and how it would behave if that light behaving as a wave comes in and around an obstruction, then it sort of paints a little bit of a picture about what happens in diffraction-limited events like this. So we have this wave that's coming in from the left. It hits this obstruction, which is right here. And there's this interference pattern that happens as those waves round the corner of this obstruction. We have some interference patterns of destruction here and constructive interference and destructive interference that seems to emanate from this point. And we can see this a little bit more true to life in a laser that goes through a pinhole that looks like this, which isn't totally replicated as a circle, but instead as a circle with concentric rings that emanate from it. And this is one of the reasons why diffraction-limited things like our pinhole lens from early on can create a softness, even though more things are actually in focus. It's because of this diffraction. This happens on a global scale throughout the entirety of our image, and that smearing of this image, which is just this physical property of light going around an obstruction, is going to then cause some blurring in our image. So there's this tension then in your selection of an F number, which is that you want to select one that perhaps will overcome some of the optical limitations of your lens, wide open. So you might step down to 5.6, 5.6, or 8, or something along those lines, but you don't want to step it down so much that you all of a sudden become diffraction limited by your sensor. And the last few seconds, I want to show you just some effects of digital artifacts. And we've talked about a lot of these, but now we'll actually get to take a look at them in some actual detail. So we have aliasing, for example. You might recall that we have an anti-aliasing filter on top of our sensor, which is essentially, I also called it a low-pass filter. I also called it like a blurring filter, and that's precisely what it looks like. It actually performs a blurring. But if we see Moira, I gave the example of a brick wall off in space, and if it actually were not able to replicate precisely that pattern because that pattern repeated at a specific frequency, or we even just shrink down our image enough. This can happen through a variety of ways, not just through our reconstruction of an image through the Bayer filter, but also just by shrinking an image with the right frequency down to the correct size, we can get this unusual pattern that can appear. And this is a Moira pattern that you see here. And of course, we also have the maze patterns that result from our internal processing in the camera to reconstruct the original colors. And finally, I want to again provide just a little bit of warning about over-sharpening your images. We talked about how, as a result of this aliasing that happens to try to fix these problems of Moira and maze patterns, we have a slightly softer image, and one way that we can combat that is to increase the sharpness of our image. But doing that too much, essentially what we're doing is finding the locations of these edges and increasing the contrast between that at that edge location. If we do it too much, we can get these so-called halos, where one side of the edge becomes too dark and the other side becomes too bright. So that's all that I have for today. I want to thank you all very much for coming. Again, I want to remind you to come next week, where we'll have a guest lecture. And 2 weeks' time, I look forward to our special pre-recorded lecture and in-person section that we'll have. So until then, thank you all very, very much for coming. We'll see you next week.